church, Palapinta County Cowboy Church, where people greet you with a smile and a shake. Glory, hallelujah, oh, what a place.
Hi, Adam and Elizabeth here. Thank you for participating with us online here at Palapinta County Cowboy Church. If you have received a blessing from this ministry today, please consider partnering in ministry with us and spreading God's word. You can do this by going to palapinacowboychurch.com, scrolling to the left side of the homepage, and clicking on the link, Click Here to Give. Thank you for partnering with us, and enjoy today's message.
Get up in Jesus' name. Get up in Jesus' name. Lord, it's calling daily those who would be saved. Don't go down the field while victory's scared to claim. Get up in Jesus' name. At the game called beautiful, laid out on the street.
Up
saved a wretch like me. Once was lost, but now am found. Blind, but now I see. Grace taught my heart to fear. Grace my fears relieved. Precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. I get a peaceful, easy feeling. I know it won't let me down. Already standing on solid ground. Many days been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun. We've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. I get a put your hand in the hand of the man who stilled the water. Put your hand in the hand of the man who calmed the sea. Take a look at yourself and you can look at us.
Sounded good today. I tell you what, we have a special guest. She's not a guest here, though. She's a member here, but when we say special guest, we like hearing her sing. Y'all welcome Pat Cleary, because Pat's going to sing a great song called Sheltered in the Arms of God. And as soon as I get the tempo, Pat, we'll start the song. Here we go. 3, 4, 1.
It's the last mile you must try.
Let's all bow in prayer. Our most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for your presence here today. We know that we are sheltered in your arms. Dear Lord, be with Roger today as he brings your message through him. We ask this all in their blessed name and for thy sake. Amen.
Amen.
Anybody besides me glad to be in the house of the Lord today? Woo! But I tell you what, I feel like I'm preaching in a brand new building. I love it. I'm telling you, I love it. This is great. How many of you enjoy the extra space when you walk in the door back there? Yeah. No more jockeying for a place at the coffee pot, right? Amen. Hey, I did want to say a quick thank you, and I don't even know if Johnny Moore is here. Is Johnny Moore here? Here he is. Johnny, Kale, Danny Beavers, those guys worked all weekend. And when I say all weekend, I mean all weekend. They really busted it trying to get this ready to go for today. Y'all give them a hand, will you? They just did a great job. We have a lot of people in this church that will step up and do what needs to be done. And, boy, I tell you, I really do appreciate that. But I appreciate you. I appreciate you being here today. I appreciate the opportunity to actually get to see all of you at one time. That's cool. I like being back up here. I really do. It's a good opportunity for me to see all your smiling faces. We do not have everything working just yet, so the screens are not going to work today. So guess what? You're going to have to go old school, and I hope you brought your Bible with you. Amen? You're going to need your Bible today, so while you're trying to find your Bible, or at least pull it up on your phone, I want to mention a couple of things real quickly to you. Hopefully you got one of these. It's Steel Hope. It is our special offering for this particular month. Steel Hope goes to the veterans that are in this community. They are working hard with veterans with PTSD. And I hope that you will make a pledge above and beyond your offering or your tithe. Please give to this. We're going to collect for the entire month and make sure that we can help out these guys. I have a very soft spot, as you can tell from last week, in my heart for all the veterans and people that have served this great country. And I want to make sure that the Palo County Cowboy Church takes care of them. Amen? That is something I feel we need to do, and so I hope that you will do that. Also, we're doing a chair fundraiser, okay? And give. I know the preacher always wants money, right? Amen? But the thing about it is, how many of you would prefer to sit in a padded chair? It'd make tolerating my sermons a whole lot better, wouldn't it? Amen? Well, $45 will buy you a chair, all right? $45 will buy you a padded chair. We've got a pretty good jump on this, and so I feel good about where we're headed. But we're going to be looking probably in the neighborhood of somewhere around $27,000 to put chairs in here. So that's a lot of money. But I figure if we all divide it up and do about $45 a piece, that's not a whole lot of money. But it is something that we could do, and we would be a whole lot more comfortable. Now, these chairs that you bought before are not going to waste, so we're not throwing them out. So before you get all excited and go, hey, I already bought one, what are we doing with that? Is they're going into our dining hall over here, all right? And we're going to have a sit-down place where in the air conditioning where all of us can eat and fellowship together. Ain't that awesome? Yeah. So we're going to use them. They're not going away, but I tell you what, I just know that having some chairs that are alike and that are padded would probably make you a lot more comfortable, and I can preach longer. Hey, I'm only serious, all right, just so you know. All right, Jonah chapter 1. Jonah chapter 1, if you have your Bible or your phone, and for those of you on the front row, you might want to use your phone because I bet you can't even see your Bible, can you? But Jonah chapter 1, we're going to talk about a guy that everybody's familiar with. Whether you've been in church a long time or just a little while, or if you've never been in church before, you've probably heard of the name Jonah. Because he is significant to a particular Bible story, and that Bible story has to do with one whale of a tale. Amen? All right, Jonah chapter 1, you stand. Gentlemen, if you'll remove your cover for me. We're going to honor God's word this morning by the reading of his word, Jonah chapter 1. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me. Its wickedness. It was a wicked city. All right, we're all clear with that. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. After paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Then the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. All the sailors were afraid, and each cried out to his own God. I love that part right there. Each cried out to his own God. And there's something we need to take from that. Not everybody serves the one true God. Amen? And they threw the cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. But Jonah had gone below deck, where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. The captain went to him and said, "How can you sleep? Get up and call on your God." Not our God. Our God's not doing it. Call on your God. "Maybe he will take notice of us so that we will not perish." Then the sailors said to each other, "Come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity." They cast lots that fell on who? Jonah. That's right. Uh-oh. We got big trouble here. So they asked him, "Tell us, who's responsible for making all this trouble for us? What kind of work do you do? Where do you come from? What is your country, and what people are you?" He answered, "I am Hebrew, and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." This terrified them, and they asked, "Then what have you done?" They knew he was running away from the Lord, because he'd already told them that he was. The sea was getting rougher and rougher, so they asked him, "What should we do to you to make the sea calm down for us?" Jonah said, "Pick me up and throw me into the sea, and it will become calm. I know that it is my fault that this great storm has come upon you." Instead, the men did their best to row back to the land, but they could not, for the sea grew even wilder than before. Now, if I were to finish this, and we'd be reading for a while, we do know that eventually these guys tossed him over. Amen? Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank you so much for the reading of your word this morning. And Father, I just pray that it would penetrate and touch our hearts today, Father, as we are in worship of you and you only. You are the one true God, and that you are the one true God that we adore and we worship this morning. Thank you for your Holy Spirit in this place. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Now, again, I left out the story of the whale. How many of you associate the whale with Jonah when you read that story? Okay. If you've ever heard that, like I said before, if you were in kindergarten, if you were in vacation Bible school, if you grew up in church, or if you just happen to go every once in a while, I guarantee you everybody makes a big deal over the whale, don't they? Everybody does. But here, I want to tell you something. I believe the story and the storyline starts before the whale ever shows up. Amen? It starts before that. And matter of fact, the whale is just a sub-story of the real story of Jonah. Because the real story of Jonah is, you can run, but you cannot hide. You can run, but you cannot hide. How many of us in here today, and you don't have to answer this, but how many of us in here today have tried our best to hide from God? We've done everything we could possibly think of. Right? Amen? Jonah was no different. He said, "I don't want to do what God's asking me to do. I'm going to do my best to turn around and go as far away from God as I can possibly go." David reminds us of this. King David reminds us of this in Psalm 139. And if you've still got your Bibles, I'd ask you to turn with me over there, because I'd like for you to mark this. Psalm 139. It reads something like this. "You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit, you know when I rise, you perceive my thoughts from afar, you discern my going out, my lying down, you are familiar with all of my ways." In other words, there is nothing you can do that God is not already familiar with. There's no thought you can have, no place you can go that God is not already there. Amen? Amen. You discern my going out and my lying down. You're familiar with all my ways. Before a word on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to tame. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go to the heavens, you're there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like day, for darkness is light to you. So even in the middle of the night, even in the middle of the times where mankind thinks that he can get away with evil, God sees it all. Nothing escapes his attention. Nothing escapes his attention. I bet I've done 30 sermons on funerals, and we've talked about this very thing. You know, a lot of things catch us off guard. Death catches us off guard. Sickness catches us off guard. But I got to tell you, nothing catches God off guard. Nothing does at all. And David says, it doesn't matter where I go. It doesn't matter what I do. It doesn't matter whether I go high or go low. If I go east, if I go west, it does not matter. You are there. Praise God for that. Amen. Praise God for that. Now, I believe that there's probably a little bit of Jonah in every single one of us in this room today. I think there is. There's something in all of us that we have been running away from and should be running towards. Something we are running away from but ought to be running to. And I believe that a lot of that is our relationship with Jesus Christ. I believe many of us in this world today run away from God. We run away from that deep relationship with God, thinking God doesn't want me. There's nothing in me that he could possibly use. There's nothing he could do inside me. Therefore, I am just going to run away from it as far as I can go. But I got to tell you something. God loves you so much that he gave his only son for you, and he wants a relationship with you one-on-one every single day. Amen? Every single day. Jonah is one of these guys that kind of gets a bad biblical rap, I think. The city of Nineveh wasn't a very good city. I was trying to think if I could play something in the United States like it, and I could probably come up with some, but then I'd get a lot of emails, and I don't want to do that. But I'm telling you, you could think of a city that you can think, hey, man, it's just got a lot of sin in it. You know, I mean, it's just probably the worst place in America to go. Okay, I'm going to do it anyway. I don't care if you get mad at me. Chicago. I hope this is on tape. Maybe this will get on its own tape. But, you know, when I think about Sin City, there's two or three places I think of. I think about Las Vegas. But I think about Chicago, you know, and I think, you know, there is a place that would be very difficult if God says, Roger, I want you to pick up. I want you to leave Cowboy Church. I want you to go to Chicago, and I want you to preach on the streets. And I got to be honest with you, I'd probably take up the attitude of Jonah just like that. Go, I don't think so, Lord. First of all, a redneck in the middle of Chicago ain't going to fare very well. Can promise you that. Let alone with how they govern things up there, I'm liable to say something that they're not going to like. In fact, I can pretty much guarantee you I will do that. But I don't know, Lord, I just don't see that being a good fit for me. And I think Jonah was the same way. Jonah knew that Nineveh had a bad reputation, a real bad reputation. And they worshiped false gods. They were doing all kinds of crazy stuff. And Jonah was thinking, you know, wait a minute, Lord, it would be much easier for me to go to someplace else that's a little bit closer or maybe a little bit farther south, because those people will be receptive. You're sending me into a place that they don't want to hear about my God. And God says, it doesn't matter. Go anyway. Go anyway. That's where I've called you to go. Amen? All right, good. Just making sure you're all there since I can't see you now. Now, The one thing about it is that God had the power to wipe Nineveh completely off the map, didn't he? And as a matter of fact, we know from previous scripture that Sodom and Gomorrah, he already did that to, right? He laid waste to it. Now, Nineveh was going to be the next city, I think, that God said, you know what, I am fixing to level this place because I have heard from people and them and the prayers that this place is an unrighteous place just full of sin and immorality, and I'm just going to lay waste to it. But before I do that, I want to give them one more chance. One more chance. And guess what, Jonah? I'm going to give them one more chance through you. So I want you to go to Nineveh, and I want you to preach the gospel, and I want you to tell them that I am who I say that I am, and that they need to repent and they need to turn from their ways. And Jonah said, that's really great stuff, Lord, but you got the wrong guy. You got the wrong guy. I am not the guy that you need to have do this. Now, I'm not sure that Jonah felt at the time that the scripture was documented that he actually thought that he was running. Think about it. You know, the Bible is not streamed in live video. It's not tweeted out in live. And so, for those of you who know what tweeting is, other than the birds, okay? Or other than the birds, that's old style. This is new style. But it's not tweeted out live. And so, Jonah, we're not getting a play-by-play in a live format. We're getting the gospel of Jonah or Jonah's account of all this after all of it's happened. Amen? So Jonah is looking back on his life, and he's looking back on this stuff, and I don't think that Jonah at the time thought, I'm running. I don't think that most people think that they're running from God at the time. If Jonah had written this while he was running, he would have said something like this. Well, I'm just being practical. I'm just being logical. I have a valid, legitimate reason for not going to Nineveh, therefore I am not going to go. I have validated it in my own mind, in my own spirit, that I don't really need to put myself in harm's way to do this, so I don't think he thought he was running. I think he thought he was using his head and saying, I don't need to do this. How many times have you and I justified stepping out of the will of God? How many times have we said, you know what, God, I know I've got this little yearning in my heart that I need to do this, but I just really don't think that I'm the right person for this. I really don't think that I need to serve inside the church. I really don't think that I need to speak to people in my school or speak to people in my community or speak to people at my work. I really don't think you have the right guy here. And I think this happens more times than not, doesn't it? And yet, there is something inside you and there's something inside me that says, no, I've called you to do this. Pardon me? This is what I want you to do. And by the way, that calling never goes away, does it? Never goes away. I remember starting or being told that I was going to start a cowboy church. And when I say I'm being told that I was going to start a cowboy church, God told me we were going to do this. God told Dana we were going to do this. And both of us looked at each other and going, man, we're not qualified to do this. There's no way. God, you got the wrong person. There's no way we can do this. As a matter of fact, I think that once that God had gotten a hold of my life about it, I said, you know something, God, you're going to have to convince my wife that this is what we need to do because I can't do this by myself, nor do I want to do it by myself. And I think it would be impossible to do by myself. I said, so here's what I'd love for you to do, God. If you really want me to do this, if this is really your will for my life, then I want you to convince my wife that this is what we need to do. And so they sent us to a school. And I said, Dan, I'd love for you to go to this school with me. Let's go listen to what cowboy church is all about because it's not like traditional church. And both of us had been in traditional church for a while. And both of us had a little bit of ill will as far as some of the methodology in a traditional church. And we had just decided, look, we need to do something different. So we both went to this school in Abilene, and I said, God, just convince her of this. Just let her know that this is what we need to do. And by the time we got through the second session of that school, she looked over at me and she said, this is what we need to do. Right here. It didn't matter that we were qualified. It didn't matter. It didn't matter that we'd never planted a church before. It didn't matter that we had no idea what to expect. But I will tell you this, there's a whole lot more of you here than we ever thought were going to be here. We thought if we ever get to 100, we're going to be in business. I guarantee you. We exceeded that and then some. And then, of course, being able to add on to this beautiful building that God's given us. I mean, I, in my right mind, never thought we'd ever get to this point. Never. Now, I don't think that's lack of faith. I'm like Jonah. I think that's just being realistic. Or I thought it was. But you see, God's purpose is greater than yours and my plans. Amen? Purpose is greater than that. So Jonah went to Joppa, and he paid a fare. You ever notice that when you run from God, it will always cost you something? Whew. And I tell you what, it seems like when you run from God, it costs you way more than what you have. Way more than what you have. And Jonah did that. Jonah said, you know what? I'm headed the other direction. I'm going to go get on a boat. I'm going to go to Joppa, pay my fare, get on a boat, and I'm going to go the opposite direction of where God intended for me to go, which is probably most of us. When God calls you to do something, there will almost always be an opportunity to catch a boat going the opposite direction. Almost always. If he calls you to do something, I guarantee you there is something that will take you in the opposite direction of where God wants you to be. Guarantee you. All right, y'all are getting quiet on me. Don't get quiet on me. If you do that, and many people have, you will wind up where you don't want to be if you are not intentional with the people that you get on the boat with. Now listen to me very carefully because this is critical. This is where most of us mess up. Because I believe with all my heart that if God calls you to do something, he's not necessarily calling the person that you're hanging out with to do the same thing. As a matter of fact, he may not be calling them at all. Not yet, okay? So if you have a calling in your life and you get on a boat with people that do not have the intention of supporting your vision or your purpose that God has put out for you, they're going to take you in the opposite direction of where God's calling you to go. It happens almost all the time. I've seen it time after time, so have you. You know that that happens. Jonah got on a boat full of people that were not headed where God told him to go. Amen. Verse 4, then the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. Make no mistake, when you're running from God, God will allow things to come into your life that will get your attention. It will happen. By the way, if you are saved, if you claim to belong to Jesus Christ, I guarantee you he's got you right here. He's not going to let you go. It doesn't matter how far you try to run or how much you try to hide. He's got you right here, and he will allow things in your life that will make you come to realize you can run, but you cannot hide. You can run, but you cannot hide. Whew. If you truly belong to him, he's not going to allow you to be content with complacency. He's not going to allow you just to sit happily in a comfortable chair at church. If you truly belong to him, he's going to put a purpose in your life, and he's going to ask you and then tell you and then command you to go do it. And by the way, I've said this a while ago, and I want to reemphasize this very quickly. His will does not change. His command does not change. If he's calling you to do something, he's not going to uncall you to do it. Simply because you don't want to. He's not going to change his mind simply because you and I don't want to do it. Here's a thought. Some of us are here today and are going through a storm in our life. And not because of who you are or what you are. but it's because of who you have on your boat. Who you have on your boat. Maybe it's time to start reevaluating who's on your boat. Who you sailing with? Who you going through life with? Is the reason that you're going through the storms because of the people that you keep around you? Is it because of the negative influence? Is it because of the fact that they're not on board with where you're going? Verse 6, the captain went to him and said, "How can you sleep?" Jonah's down here in the bottom of this boat, not paying a bit of attention because he thinks he's escaped God. God can't find me down here. I'm asleep. I'm just going to rest. When we get to where we're going, I'll be as far away from what God is wanting me to do as I can be. And the captain comes down and says, "Get up and call on your God." Now, here's the thing I think you and I have got to remember. Not everybody, as I said a while ago, worships the same God. Now, I know that here in America, they keep saying we're all headed in the same direction and we're all worshiping one God. That is crappeth. Crappeth. It is not the same God. We worship the one true God, the God of the heavens, the God of the earth, the God of all creation, the God of all mankind. That is the one we worship. If you're not on board with that, or you have a person on your boat that's not on board with that, they need to go over the side. Over the side. Now, I'm not telling you not to love them, so don't misunderstand me. I'm not telling you that you still can't minister to them. I'm saying that you don't need them on your boat. Big difference. Big difference in that, okay? Then the sailors said to each other, "Come, let us cast lots to find out who's responsible for this calamity." They cast lots, and the lot fell on, one more time, the lot fell on, yeah, okay, just want to make sure you realize who we're talking about today. Yeah, same guy, all right? And so they ask him, "Tell us, who is responsible for making all this trouble for us?" In other words, they're saying, what is the problem here? We were sailing along doing just fine. All of a sudden, we have giant problems, and we're fixing to lose our ship. Tell us who's responsible for making all this trouble. What kind of work do you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? From what people are you? And he answered, "I am Hebrew." Which, by the way, Hebrew, if you are Hebrew going to Nineveh, that's a very bad combination. They didn't like Hebrews, okay? And Jonah already knew that they had a problem here, all right? "I'm Hebrew." This terrified them, and they asked, "What have you done?" For they knew that he was running from God. Praying to God while you're running in the opposite direction doesn't have near the credibility as praying to God when you're going where he wants you to go. Just doesn't have the same credibility. So Jonah tells these shipmates of his, "Hey, I can pray to the God that I worship, but I'm going to tell you something. It's not going to do any good." He already knew. He already knew that his sin was running away from what God had told him to do. He already knew that once I have sinned, there is a consequence to sin. There is a consequence. And the consequence is, hey, I'm going in the opposite direction, and this ain't going to work, right? It ain't going to work. Are y'all with me? Okay, good. Quick word here. Once again, there's people in your life, people on friends on Facebook, people on your contact list and your phone that you need to throw off of your boat. And I guarantee you some of us in this congregation today have been talking and carrying on conversations and becoming real chummy with a lot of the Jonas in our life. Here's the thing. People around you will be glad to take you where they are going if you don't know where you're headed. You need to know where you're headed. I need to know where I'm headed. I need to be confident in the God that I worship and the confident in the direction that he's taking me and go in that direction. Now, the part we didn't read, most of you are, again, familiar with this part, how God orchestrated the big fish, which we like to call a whale, to swallow Jonah, where Jonah stayed for 3 days. Now, I'm just going to touch on this briefly. I didn't have you read this, but I think this is a real good part of the story. So before we shut her down today, I want to talk about this. Now, you'd have to know the mind of the Lord to know exactly how God would orchestrate a fish like this to be in the exact spot at the exact time that they tossed Jonah overboard, right? Now, what's interesting about this whale is that this whale had more sense than Jonah did. This whale followed God's direction even when Jonah did not. What does that say for mankind? The book of Jonah is about a rescue, and it's about reconciliation. So I want to ask you a question this morning. Has there ever been a time in your life where God rescued you from a situation that your own disobedience created? Your own disobedience created. Notice that the accommodations for Jonah's rescue were not all that accommodating. He didn't send a cruise ship. He didn't send another freight liner. He didn't even send another boat. God sent something that Jonah, when he got swallowed by, was in the pit of and in the darkness of, and he had nothing else to do but sit there and think about, boy, I wish I had gone to Nineveh. You ever felt like that? You ever felt like that? Have you ever said, man, I tell you what, I just feel like I'm in the belly of a whale. I'm in the darkest place that I can think of, and boy, it just stinks. And I just feel like there's no escape from it. But the thing about being in the belly of the whale for all of us is it certainly gives us an opportunity to not be distracted by the things that got us there to start with. And I always wondered, why wouldn't God send a cruise ship to pick up Jonah? Well, if he had, it'd be just like you and me. If God makes the way easy for you and I to get out of something, then what are we most likely to do? Keep going the direction that is away from God. Well, I got out of that. There wasn't any consequence to it. Piece of cake. I could do what I want to do. It's not going to hurt me. I got out of that. Nobody knew. It was all over and done with, and everything's cool. But Jonah didn't have that luxury, and you and I do not have that luxury at all either, because I guarantee you, as I said before, sin has consequence. Sin has consequence. Have you ever noticed that when God rescues you, sometimes it's not, I'm off scot-free. God would say, I need to put you in a dark place for a short time, Jonah, so you will remember what disobedience feels like. So you will remember what disobedience feels like. Now, there are two things that always pleases God in our life. You ready? Write them down. These are two things that always pleases God. Faith and obedience. Faith and obedience. And here's how I know that. Jonah 2, 9 and 10 says, but I, with the shouts of grateful praise, will sacrifice to you what I have vowed I will make good. I will say, my salvation, my rescue, my reconciliation, my relationship comes from the Lord. Comes from the Lord. It can come from anything else. Now, here's what I want to leave you with this morning. Isn't it amazing that when we surrender not only to the will of God, but we surrender our praise and follow through with our vow to God, that he is faithful and just to deliver us from all unrighteousness? He's faithful to do that. But you have to surrender to that. You have to say, it is not my will, Lord, it is yours. It's not my way, it is yours. I'm not going to run from you. I'm going to run towards you. One other thing you and I need to notice. God didn't change his mind. Jonah was still going to Nineveh. It didn't matter how far he ran, he was still going to Nineveh. As a matter of fact, when he got out of the belly of the whale, where did he go? Nineveh. He just went with a very different attitude. A very different attitude. The purpose was the same. The plan was the same. It was the attitude in the heart that was different. You can run, but you can't hide. You can think you've out-manipulated God. You can think you've outsmarted God. You can think you've gotten as far as you think you can go from God. But you and I will never outrun him, outsmart him, outwill him, or outgive him. God, from this day forth, our prayer should be, I will make good on the vow that I committed to you. And you did that when you accepted him into your heart. When you said, I want to make Jesus Christ my Lord and Savior, you vowed that you would be his and that he would be yours. That is a vow. I will make good on that vow. Why? Because my salvation, my rescue comes from you. I want to ask if you'll bow your head this morning. Gentlemen, if you'll remove your hat. Now, I want you to think about your own life. What are you running away from that you need to be running towards? And maybe that is your relationship with Jesus Christ. Maybe you're here this morning and you've never done that because you've been running and running and running thinking, I tell you, there's just nothing in me that God can use. And maybe you're here this morning, and maybe you're here for the first time this morning, and God is tapping on your heart going, you know, it is no accident that you are here. It is by plan. And I want you to hear what I am capable of doing through you if you will just be obedient and allow me to do it. This morning, he's asking for your allegiance, and he's asking for your obedience. Here's the great thing about it. I can't give you that, and nobody else around here can give you that, but he can. And he can give you that relationship right where you sit this morning. I'm not going to call you up to the front. I'm not going to ask you to stand. I'm not going to ask you to lift your hand. I'm not going to ask you to do anything. Because I believe with all my heart that what you do between you and God is going to be between you and God this morning. He's the only one that's going to save you, and he's the only one that's going to give you a purpose. But he wants to do that. He's asking you today to be receptive to that and acknowledge him as Lord and Savior of your life. He's asking you to be obedient and say, I want you to come into my heart, and I want you to give me purpose and a plan for my life. And he will do that. Maybe you've already given your life to Christ, but maybe you're just not walking in the direction that you're supposed to walk. Maybe you're running away from, just like Jonah was, the calling on your life. Maybe today is the day that you need to submit to Almighty God and say, I'm going to quit running away from you and start running towards you. Father, we come to you this morning. Father, we say thank you for all that you are and all that you do. Father, thank you for being in this place today. Father, I believe in this place today are men and women, Father, who are running away from you. And Father, I just ask right now, Father, that you would penetrate their hearts through your Holy Spirit and cause them to have a need for obedience. Father, that they would reconcile with you this morning, they would come to grips with the fact that they have run as far as they can run and they've still not been able to hide. Father, help us all to know that we need to move towards a relationship with you on a daily basis. Father, I also believe that there's somebody here who may not have a relationship with you. And today may be the day, Father, that is life-changing to them. Father, the day that they realize that they've been trying to hide, they've been trying to run, but that you and your presence, Father, have just been all over them. And today you brought them to a place where they can come and they can quietly understand who you are and what you are in their life. And Father, I just pray right now that you would intervene in their life. Father, that they'd receive you, they would open the door of their heart, that they would let you in. Father, that they would receive you as Lord and Savior of their life. Father, that they would agree that you died on the cross for their sin, all of it. Father, that they would also agree that you rose from the grave and defeated death and hell. Father, that eternity is theirs by simply receiving you as Savior and Lord in heaven. Father, thank you for loving us. Thank you for loving us in spite of the fact that we all have a lot of Jonah in us. Thank you for your message this morning. Pray, Father, that it would just move in our hearts as we leave this place. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Thank you for watching this week's message, and we hope you'll come and give us a look this Sunday. Here you'll find some of the finest country gospel music in the state of Texas, along with good, sound, Bible-based preaching. And I promise, you'll always be greeted with a handshake and a smile. Won't you come join us this Sunday at 10:30 a.m., and we'll have the coffee ready.